Thank you, sir, very much. Now, ladies and gentlemen, KDVA and CUSIP are very honored to have Dr. John Hamre, the CSIS President and CEO, provide the keynote remarks. Dr. Hamre is well known to all of us for his untiring efforts in masterfully guiding CSIS for the past 21 years to its prominence and world renown. There's no doubt about that. He was the 26th Deputy Secretary of Defense, Chairman of the Defense Policy Board, a professional staff member of the Senate Armed Services Committee, and this one is very interesting, at least to me. He was a Rockefeller Fellow at the Harvard Divinity School. So, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Hamre, a truly gifted leader who believes in giving back. Sir.
I apologize for having to wear all this stuff, but I, you know, I'm the only person in the room that isn't immunized, I'm afraid. I tried, but I have a compromised immune system, and so it didn't work. So I have to be a little more careful, and I apologize for the little distance here. And I'm very grateful that you invited me, General Brooks, and so good to see you, General Scaparotti. It's been a long time, too long. You did such a fabulous job in Korea. We felt that, okay, we'll give you second best, we'll let you go to Europe. And you did a fabulous job there, too. Thank you. And to see you, General Jung, I'm privileged that you were with us at CSIS for a while, and I'm grateful for that. You know, when General Brooks called and asked if I would step in, originally Kurt Campbell was going to come, and he would be far better than me. But I know what it's like, because I do conferences a lot too, and when all of a sudden you lose your speaker, I completely understand. And so I was flattered and very honored that you did ask me. And I was talking with General Brooks about what we talk about, and you know, we've worked together. We worked together this last year on a big report on the future of the alliance. So I had every intention of kind of giving you a very boring rundown on that little report, you know. But something happened this morning. I agreed to do a very early conference that started at 6 o'clock this morning with a think tank that works for the Korean Foreign Ministry. And so we spent 3 hours this morning in a conversation. I was on a panel, and there was one of the panelists was a Chinese academic who's very high in circles, and he said something that just pissed me off, and I totally changed my whole approach on what I was going to talk to you about today. And so forgive me, it's going to be very different than you thought it was going to be, Vince. But and I'll say, you know, we were talking about you know, the prospects of peace on the Korean Peninsula and denuclearization for North Korea, etc. And at one point, this Chinese academic, and no disrespect to him, I mean, he's actually a good person, but he's very senior, and so I know he's talking about the way they're talking to themselves. And he said, and I wrote it down because I was so startled by it, he said that, you know, senior leaders in China are starting to question whether they should help the U.S. with its North Korea problem. Okay, let me say that again. China is asking, should we help the U.S. with its North Korea problem? Now, I, at the time, responded by saying, we don't have a North Korea problem. Now, we've spent a couple hundred billion dollars investing in a missile defense system that's designed to stop North Korean missiles from attacking us. Now, you know, people that don't have a military background, General Jung knows this, of course, military officers know this. The purpose of a missile defense program isn't just to stop wave after wave after wave of missiles. It's designed to buy time so that in about 30 minutes, we can send missiles back and completely destroy North Korea. And we can do that. So our system will do that. So in one very narrow sense, America doesn't have a North Korea problem. Who has a North Korea problem? Well, it's China. It's also Korea. And it's also Japan. Okay, and because we have an alliance, most important alliance, in my view, is with our Asian partners. Because we have an alliance, we do have a Korea problem. Because we have an obligation to defend those allies. Now, when this academic said, basically, we're not going to help you with North Korea. That's really what those words said. We're not going to help you with North Korea. Okay, now that means we, Korea, US, partners, we have to seriously start saying, well, what do we do if there's a permanently nuclear North Korea? This is an issue. Now, the foundation of our alliance, not the foundation, but a very important dimension of our alliance, is something called extended deterrence. Now, it's a term of art that has evolved over many years, where extended deterrence means America has asked Korea and Japan not to build their own nuclear weapons. We will provide nuclear deterrence in exchange. If you don't build them, we will make ourselves vulnerable by ensuring your security against nuclear intimidation. That's what extended deterrence means. But that's a very narrow definition of extended deterrence, because what makes it extended? Well, it's an extension of the deep military partnership we have with each other. The most important part of extended deterrence is the competence and the strength and the professionalism of the ROC military. Who is going to carry the primary burden of a fight against North Korea? It's going to be the ROK military. That is what extended deterrence means. But it means we have to be in the deepest possible partnership with each other for it to be credible. And so this is why I'm so glad you asked me to come. Because these organizations that are sponsoring this conference are at that core of what constitutes our mutual commitment to each other. Our mutual commitment to extend deterrence to protect both of our societies. Now, I don't think that we should give up on the possibility of trying to get a denuclearized North Korea. But I do think we also have to seriously say, what happens if China really does what he said? We're no longer going to help with this problem. I don't know what possible incentive could be brought upon North Korea if China decides they're going to just sit back. I don't know what that is. And so we have to be seriously talking with each other about how credible is extended deterrence. Now, I think this is a discussion we should be having in the United States. We've not had this kind of a debate in the United States about what does extended deterrence mean when we say it. We are saying as a nation, we don't want you to have a nuclear weapon, but we're going to have it for you, and we're going to defend you, and that means we have to put our cities at risk on your behalf. Now, how many American politicians are having that conversation back home with their citizens? Not very many. You know, but that's the core, okay? So we have to start a fresh discussion, because if this Chinese academic is right, and my suspicion is that he probably is, the Chinese government is starting to say, we're not going to lift a finger. We're not going to do anything. And that means we now have to rest, fall back on what's foundational for us. What does it take to protect and defend our citizens, our shared citizenry? As many of you know, I have a Korean godson. Korea's in my blood, okay? So this is not an academic thing for me. It's very real. But we have to think about very clearly, what does it mean for us together to deter a North Korea that has nothing else in the world that gives it any power except nuclear weapons? And if they won't abandon them, what do we do together? There's been a lot of questioning in Korea. I remember reading an op-ed, probably 8 years ago. It was in Chosun Ilbo that asked the question, can we really count on America's guarantee? I personally thought it was very bad when President Trump said, well, I don't really care about short-range missiles, North Korean missiles. I only care about long-range missiles. Because what did that say? He said, I'm not going to care about a missile that can attack my ally. That was so bad. That was so fundamentally bad about the commitment that we have to each other with extended deterrence. Now, I'm glad that we got past that. There were other people in the Trump administration that got that in control. And I thank you, General Brooks. You were in the front line a lot for that, I know. And it was not easy. But we have people now probably in Korea that are asking, can we really count on the United States? Are they really going to be there? We kind of see an attitude in the U.S. that they don't care so much anymore about this alliance. These are big, important questions. And it all came to a focus this morning when I listened to this guy say, China now thinks that North Korea is an American problem. Well, that's not the case, folks. It's our shared problem. We're not going to walk away from it. We can't. But it also means we need to have a deeper conversation with each other about what it means to provide extended deterrence for Koreans and for Americans. And so I hope that in your very, very important work today and when you go back, we put this as a focus for all of us. We will not be able to say that our children's and grandchildren's future is safe until we again find the foundation of our commitment, and extended deterrence is going to be a very important part of that going forward. So, as I said, this was not the speech that I promised General Brooks, but it's the one I had to give you. Thank you for having me.